two more Breeders' Cup Championship races to contest here at Arlington Park. We turn our attention now to the John Deere Breeders' Cup Turf. Only a field of eight. This is the smallest field in the turf history. But a very good field it is indeed. Look at number five, High Chaparral. He's at even money. He is from the Aidan O'Brien stable, the English and Irish Derby winner. He is a lovely horse indeed and should be very, very hard to beat in here this afternoon. Now we'll go down to Kenny Rice in the paddock.
Charles C. Falcon Flight has won twice over this track in the last year and a half. Don Burke has been the trainer of Falcon Flight in that period of time. He just started training about then. The man beside you, Gary Tanaka, is the one that hired you after you were a bloodstock agent, right? He got you to come back and be a trainer. How'd that work?
I apparently had some confidence. You have some confidence in me?
Gary, why did you hire him?
Well, Don has had an extensive background in bloodstock. I mean, he's been working with Charlie and Dick Lundy and Jeremy Noseda, so he's really been through the ropes.
You come into this 11 years ago. You were associated with the Breeders' Cup champ. Opening verse, won the mile. You were her groom working for Dick Lundy. What made you, was it a tough decision to decide to become a trainer again? You've seen how the ins and outs are.
Well, the trick is you need decent horses to train. You know, it's like John Wooden said. He said, I'm a great coach, but if I didn't have good players, how could I do it? So if you start training bad horses, and you find yourself starving, and you can't do it anymore.
Falcon Flight good enough today?
Absolutely. We wouldn't come here if we didn't think we were good enough.
Good luck to you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Don Burke, who just took out his training license just about a year and a half ago. He's won two stakes races. Both of those have been with Falcon Flight. Both of those races over the turf here at Arlington Park. Now let's go to Bob.
Well, some of us, it takes a little longer to realize our dreams than others. Sid Port is 91 years old. He's Chicago through and through. He's suffered through the Cubs. You've been a horse owner. You've had Charlie Whittingham as your trainer. You just bought Ballon Gary. And it's finally come true. You're at the Breeders' Cup in your own hometown.
Nothing could be better. It's a dream that any owner in racing has. And if you get a chance to realize it, that's pretty good. If you win it, it's even better.
And Ballon Gary, Laura DeSiro, good luck, Sid.
Thank you very much.
All right, Sid Port, 91 years young. God love you. Mike.
So, Laura, it would be pretty nice to win for an owner like Sid Port. Now, you've already won one today with Azaria. You've had her all her life. Ballon Gary, that's another story. This is his first start for you. As a matter of fact, you've only seen him train a couple of times.
Yeah, we got out of the quarantine on Tuesday, and we trained Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
And your husband, Emmanuel, picked this horse out, as he does so many of your horses. What did he see about this horse? Did you help him pick him out, by the way?
No, he only asked me to look at the tapes. I had to go look at the tapes. And, he was placed in the Irish Derby. He was placed in the Italian Derby. He won a good group race in France called the Prix Noailles. So it was the week before the Canadian International, and Emmanuel had an inkling that he was going to run very well because he looked physically very well.
And, of course, he was trained by Aidan O'Brien at the time. Aidan O'Brien has the favorite in here. Would that be a little poetic justice for you to jump up and beat the favorite with Ballon Gary?
Well, I just hope he runs well. I mean, the High Chaparral's beaten him been a better horse in the past, but anything can happen here in American racing with the, you know, smaller turf courses and tighter turns, and let's just go try.
All right, good luck to Laura DeSiro, trainer of Ballon Gary.
All right, Mike, thank you very much. And, of course, Ballon Gary had been trained by Aidan O'Brien, and there we're looking at him walking out. That's the back of Aidan O'Brien. He's very youngish-looking, rather shy and quiet, but quite a wizard at training horses, and that is his High Chaparral right there. Let's meet the field now. Here they go, a mile and a half on the turf for $2 million, and this is Denon, the Turf Classic winner, races for a partnership of his breeder, the Niarchos family, and longtime Franco client, Edmund Gann, who owns Medaglia d'Oro. He provided some really gripping battles this summer with Anticipation, who he meets in here today. Here comes Ballon Gary. We just met his owner, Sid Port. He is an Irish Invader, which has obviously now been bought here, and he was purchased right after he won the Canadian International, and Sid Port is a great benefactor of the arts here in Chicago, and this horse has looked like an oil painting himself this week. Falcon Flight is another of those European purchases by Gary Tanaka we spoke of earlier with Golden Apples. He had a brutal traffic trip in the Arlington Million, and he is a factor at a price. Always tries hard. And here's Golan and his stablemate Islington race for the estate of the late Lord Weinstock, whose Pilsudski won the turf in 1986. All of these horses trained by Sir Michael Stout, who seeks his third Breeders' Cup win. And next in line will be the favorite, High Chaparral, getting all the attention at the windows and deservedly so. The English and Irish Derby winner fell prey to the virus that swept through Aidan O'Brien's yard this year. He rebounded, but was unable to get a prep race, so he had to run him straight in the Prix de l'Arc de Triomphe, and he ran very well in there. Needed the race and will be tough to beat today. Here's Perfect Soul, an Irish bred colt by Sadler's Wells, has raced exclusively in Canada and looks for his first stakes victory today. He's trained by Roger Atfield. At the other extreme is This Old Fellow With Anticipation. He's gotten quite a following, seven-year-old gelding, Snow White practically. He's won over $2 million and has this really melodramatic come-from-behind running style. Comes flying late, just bounds like a deer through the stretch. Big question mark as to whether he'll be able to handle the soft turf. Unlike this fellow, the Tin Man, he'll be on the lead, and he probably will like the going. He'll be setting the pace. He's won 6 of 11 starts after bowing a tendon as a two-year-old. Dick Mandela has won two Breeders' Cups with Cota Shan and Phone Chatter. That's the field. It's a little less to pick from, but I'll see if the boys can pick a winner here.
Well, with a short field, Mike, this is a very unusual race. This is the shortest field in this turf's history.
Right.
I think we're going to see a real chess match among the riders. I anticipate a slow pace. That's going to be jockey around for the best position.
Yeah, you know Mike Smith's going to the front with the Tin Man, and could be a dangerous horse, but I'll tell you what, Bob, High Chaparral, the favorite, just looks awfully strong. Take a look at him on the track right now. This horse looks awfully strong to me. He's 4-5 at the moment. He was coming off a 6-race win streak. Back in June, he was one of the horses in the O'Brien barn that came down with a virus. He was off for over 3 months. He came back in the Arc de Triomphe, and he ran a very respectable third. He had to need that race. After that time off, he had to need that race. I think he's only going to move forward with that one under his belt. The mile and a half, he loves that. He's already proven it. And I think Golan is the only horse in here that could beat him. I think the two Europeans just kind of stand out over this field.
Well, the question is, did the illness set him back? And for that reason, I have to go against him. And I love this whole Sid Port story. 91 years old, a Chicago guy through and through. They made the arrangements to buy Ballengarry. Of course, that was even before the great race he ran at Woodbine, and he went beautifully that day. Of course, he was an old Coolmore horse that day, Ballengarry, and here he is, and this was a spectacular run against a very, very good field that day. Granted, Ballengarry lost to High Chaparral earlier this year, but maybe he can turn the tables. Look at those ears pricking. I mean, this horse has run on his mind. Today, he'll have Kent DeSormo in the irons for Laura DeSaroux. And Ballengarry, who's a square price, I think, at 8 or 9 to 1. I don't know how Mutton Chops feels about this one. I don't know if he thinks this is a shoe-in for High Chaparral, but I got to shop for a price here, my friend.
What do you think, John?
Way back in the Irish Derby, not rated by Ballydoyle at all. Europe have been 1-2-5 times. They're given the exacta in this. It's between Golan and High Chaparral. Remember, High Chaparral, third in the arc. 13 horses placed 1-2-3 in the arc have run in the turf. Only one has won, Pilsudski at Woodbine in 96.
So are you saying you've given us the exacta 5 years in a row?
Not in a row, but five times.
I quite remember five times.
So it's
a cold box today.
It is.
Golan and High Chaparral?
It is, and Golan was 11-4 top price in England, mainly 9-4 and 2-1. Is now 4-1. He'll be back from 5-1 to 4-1. Odds on High Chaparral is a very, very short price. Irish confidence supreme behind High Chaparral. But I think Golan is just the one. At the price, you look at the value and the price, 4-1 Golan against 5-4 on High Chaparral. Between the two, they cannot get beaten. Ballengarry has got no chance.
No chance, Newmy. The two of them were trained at Ballydoyle. Let's go back upstairs.
By the way, Mike Battaglia, 3 of 6 so far. Newmy, 2 of 6. And as best we can determine, the selection of Mutton Chops, indecipherable, but I believe he has Sir Barton, Whirlaway, and Citation just as backups. And we'll be back after this.
Takes experience, strong financial backing, and a record of success to get to the Breeders' Cup and to become the world's leading fractional aircraft ownership program. net jets, all the benefits of private jet ownership, and more, at a fraction of the cost.
Now enjoy Guinness anywhere. Authentic Guinness draft in a bottle.
Is briquette French for little brick?
Yeah. Anyway, listen up. A barbecue grill manufacturer introduces a new model so big it puts all other ones to shame.
Even the really shiny ones?
Yeah, even the really shiny ones. Keep up. They rely on FedEx Ground to get affordable nationwide B2B delivery with a money-back guarantee.
And backyard gourmets get the thriller of the griller. Must be a real knockout.
It's the greatest.
The undisputed heavyweight broiler of the world.
All right, that's enough.
It's Long John Silver's boatload of seafood. Crunchy shrimp, batter dip shrimp, plus our famous batter dip fish and sides. Our biggest variety platter ever, just $6.99. Our biggest combo, just $3.99. So much great seafood for such a great price, it turns any place into seafood country.
Year after year, people you know and trust feed more and more of us. All for as little as 7 cents of our food dollar. No other country has such a healthy diet or such variety in agriculture. So the next time you meet a farmer or rancher, say thanks to the growers of things we eat and the fiber we wear. The North American farmer, putting food on our table.
We've watched them from the beginning and shared all of their joy.
I promise you my laughter and my tears, as long as we both shall live.
Now, Niles faces a personal battle that neither he or his family ever saw coming.
What's going on?
Frasier, this November on NBC.
We're back at Arlington Park, where the field for the Breeders' Cup turf is about to approach the starting gate, which is sitting about two-thirds of the way down the backside. They'll break almost into that first turn there. And as you can see, High Chaparral, the English and Irish Derby winner, is at 4-5. He is all they're talking about here. Some attention to Golan, the European invaders, getting the attention. But Bob Neumeier has another idea.
Well, Chelsea, just as a point of recognition, we know High Chaparral is by Sadler's Wells. Number 6, Perfect Soul, is also by Sadler's Wells. Ballengarry is by Sadler's Wells. 6 horses in the Breeders' Cup today are by this magnificent sire. He's 21 years old. He's out of the Northern Dancer line in Europe. He raced only 2 years, won 6 times in 11 starts. He is the most significant and influential stallion of grass horses in our time. He has 3 here, the offspring of the great Sadler's Wells. Just tip your cap to this guy. He's an oldie but a goodie, and he's got 3 in here in Ballengarry, Perfect Soul, number 6, and the favorite, High Chaparral.
Bobby Frankel naturally is a happy man after picking up a victory earlier today, and with Denon, he thinks that there's a chance here that this is the kind of surface that might fit well, as far as he is concerned, to be on a track that is yielding at this time. Looking back, he's been able to run well here in the past. As you take a look at him, the number 1 horse there, currently at 7-1. That's up a little bit from his morning line. But I asked him back in the paddock, think you can make it two straight here? And he says, yeah, I think I got a good shot. You never know, but the track seems to be playing maybe the way that Denon will like to run there, with Edgar Prado aboard, who's just missed once today, coming up with a second in the sprint. He should take another look at the number 1 there, Denon, now, who has won 2 out of 6 this year. Now let's go upstairs as Ballengarry, a little excited going into the gate, to Tom Durkin to call the Breeders' Cup turf.
We'll begin to line for the Breeders' Cup turf, and there is Golan, Kieran Fallon aboard. Mr. Fallon did not exactly bathe himself in glory with his ride aboard Hold That Tiger in the last race. There goes Falcon Flight, moving in the professional that he is. There is Golan. Kieran Fallon aboard. And the odds are 7-2 for he. And the 4-5 favorite here is High Chaparral, winner of the Irish and English Derby. Final horse moving into line. The Tin Man, ready for the start of the 9th Breeders' Cup turf, and they're off. Falcon Flight broke well, and Golan got off last. Racing for the fire turn, there goes the Tin Man now, who takes the initiative, and the Tin Man, the expected front runner. second. And then it's High Chaparral who's put in the mix early on the outside. Danon. Danon is now third, and High Chaparral is eased back into fourth position. Falcon Flight racing in fifth, and the Canadian Perfect Soul is sixth in the early going. Golan has found his way to the inside, and with Anticipation, who led in the early stages of last year's Breeders' Cup Turf, is the trailer this year in the early going. Long way to go yet, and the Tin Man is just coasting on an uncontested lead. The Tin Man just cruising along here. The opening quarter went in a pokey 25 and 3/5 seconds. Ballengary is second. Danon's got a cozy spot third under the line for the first time. And then it's Perfect Soul who's pulling his way up to the leaders in fourth position. A dawdling half of 51-1 for the Tin Man. High Chaparral is running fifth, tracking Ballengary into the fire turn. Then Falcon Flight followed by Golan and the big white horse with Anticipation on the outside. A tight pack through easy fractions early, and the Tin Man continues to cruise uncontested here. A two-length lead. Ballengary running second as they make their run into the backstretch now. The Tin Man takes the field into the backstretch run. Ballengary sitting chilly in second. Danon rides the rails with Edgar Prado in third position. Perfect Soul is in the clear running along in fourth. High Chaparral is yet to do his best running, but now Mick Cannon is giving him his cue. He's five lengths behind. The Tin Man, who leads with four furlongs to go, still at the back. Our Falcon Flight with Anticipation. Golan is the last of them all. Racing into the fire turn, it's still the Tin Man. The Tin Man in front at 15-1 going into the fire turn with a host of pursuers. Ballengary has been second throughout. On the inside, Danon is ready to roll from third. Here comes with Anticipation. With Anticipation with a bold move on the outside. And High Chaparral right there. The stage is set as they turn for home. The Tin Man to catch on the outside with Anticipation. High Chaparral is coming with a furious run with one furlong to go. And he races to the lead. High Chaparral in front. He blew right by the Tin Man with Anticipation a second. Falcon Flight is third. And High Chaparral is under the line to win it by a length and a half. A valiant effort from the good Gray, old Gray, with Anticipation to finish second there. And finishing third was Falcon Flight. Well, they salvaged this afternoon with the victory here, the Aiden O'Brien, Michael Tabor team. It's been a very disappointing day for them, to say the least, so far. But they have won with the 4-5 favorite, High Chaparral, in the Breeders' Cup turf. Mick Cannon was the picture of patience throughout. He was just sitting chilly, biding his time, drafting in behind horses, as is High Chaparral's custom. And then when they turned for home, he ran to daylight and blew them away. And there is the mild-mannered master of Ballydoyle, the young Aiden O'Brien, accepting congratulations for victory here in the 19th Breeders' Cup Turf. Michael Tabor, the winning owner. The final time here was 2 minutes and 30 seconds. Mick Cannon was aboard the winner. Michael Tabor had, of course, Landseer earlier today. It was a real low point, obviously, with Landseer. But they pick it up here with the victory. Let's go to Donna.
All right, I'm here with Mick. Name Mick, congratulations. I interviewed you last year when you won on Johannesburg, and I know you love to win these Breeders' Cup races. Congratulations.
Yeah, thanks. It was good. Just deserved for this horse, you know.
I know this is a nice horse. They make their own luck. But did you get the kind of trip you needed?
I thought it'd be a little bit more pace. I thought maybe Ballengary might have applied more pace because he really stays really that well, and they didn't really go that quick. Ideally, I would like to be maybe a bit more forward, but he's classy enough to go and pick them up, you know.
Yeah, the Tin Man with Mike Smith had things his own way on the lead, but it looked like when you asked him to kick in for you, he sure gave.
He went very easy because this little idle's a lot in front. He went to the front very easy and just was having a look, you know. So, yeah, it's a nice consolation after the rock getting beat.
Oh, all right, Mick, thank you very much. All right, Charlesy.
Hey, Donna, thank you very much. What a great finish by High Chaparral and a wonderfully patient ride by Mick Cannon. High Chaparral coming through the stretch, storming up to take over from the Tin Man, who'd shown all the pace. A great show by this Irish-based horse. I know they're watching at Cashel in County Kildare, and they're watching at Fethard in County Tipperary. Congratulations to you all. Great ride, great race. High Chaparral.
Year after year, people you know and trust feed more and more of us, all for as little as 7 cents of our food dollar. No other country has such a healthy diet or such variety in agriculture. So the next time you meet a farmer or rancher, say thanks to the growers of things we eat and the fiber we wear. The North American farmer, putting food on our table.
Now enjoy Guinness anywhere. Authentic Guinness draft in a bottle.
There's something of Ireland in all of us. Music, the poetry, the warmth of that Emerald Isle where my mother was born. And the soft words of my mother's songs and the soft mists keep calling me back. There's never been a better time to visit. Come with me to Ireland.
1 week vacation from $499, including airfare, accommodation, and rental car. For your free travel kit, call 1-800-SHAMROCK or visit shamrock.org.
I spend every day in salt water. Great for my body. Tough on my hair. My solution? All new VO5 milks. Shampoos and conditioners with vitamin A and soy milk protein. They build back the shine and make my hair look and feel incredible. Try strawberries and cream, creamy fresh peaches, and piña colada. They'll leave your hair looking fresh and fabulous. If VO5 milks can make my hair look this good, imagine what it can do for yours.
I printed and collated the color report that won the big account and got us into a larger office. And this is the respect I get? I need a hug.
Toshiba copiers make you look good.
They come from around the nation and the world. Winners, champions, individuals who excel at what they do. On their way, their every need is attended to, their safety of the utmost importance. We speak, of course, of the thoroughbreds running in today's race and the people who flew the world's leading fractional aircraft ownership program to come watch them. NetJets. All the benefits of private jet ownership and more at a fraction of the cost.
Back at Arlington Park, and a blanket of flowers across the withers of one High Chaparral, emblematic of victory in the Breeders' Cup Derf. Mick Cannon was aboard the winner. He was the favorite, returned to $3.80 to win, $3 in the middle and $2.60. Seven-year-old with anticipation got up to complete the exacta. Falcon Flight was third. The exacta returned $34.80, and the trifecta $233, and a pretty good superfecta as well. Let's go downstairs to Kenny Rice.
Thank you, Tom Durkin. Pat Day aboard with anticipation. The big gray that looks white making a sweeping move on the outside about the time High Chaparral was, Pat. That's been the move that with anticipation won three grade one stakes in a row this year. Did you think he was able to get it one more time?
Well, I felt real good in the middle of the turn. You know, I got to compliment Jonathan Shepherd. We talked about the race. He said, Pat, he said, look, let's change things up a little bit on this horse. He's been jumping into the race, but he doesn't have that quick acceleration that he showed, you know, earlier in his career. He was concerned that these horses would get the jump on him and bounce him around off the turn if he was up close and wouldn't finish. He said, take him back and let's try to make one sweeping move. We did that and just got outrun by a better horse. But my compliments to Jonathan. He's done an awesome job with this horse. My compliments to With Anticipation. He put forth a huge effort. We were just second best today.
Okay, Pat, thanks for your time. Good luck.
Thank you.
I know that's a special horse for Pat Day With Anticipation. It was back in the middle of the summer at Saratoga in the Sword Dancer aboard With Anticipation that Pat Day became the all-time leading money-winning jockey, going over $264 million back in August aboard With Anticipation. Now let's go over to Bob Neumeier.
All right, Kenny, when he waltzed around at about 117, Trevor, we were wondering whether the Tin Man would not be like the character in The Wizard of Oz, and he might have a heart and might be able to withstand, but the class showed at the top of the lane.
Class always tells, doesn't it? And this race just fell right into High Chaparral's hands when they went so slow. He thought he was back in England again. That's how they run in England. They run the half mile, 51, 52 seconds, and of course Mick Kinney knows how to handle that kind of pace, and he made the move at exactly the right time, too. I thought the Tin Man might sneak away with it, getting such an easy lead out there, but he was tackled at just the right time. With Anticipation, if he'd gone a little earlier than that, Mick Kinney might have been in a little bit of trouble. We'll see right here as they both make the move right here. Now, this is With Anticipation, the gray on the outside, and there's Mick Kinney in the striped cap now coming through between them. The Tin Man is down at the rail, but this one was perfectly timed, and you know, he's an Epsom Derby winner. You can win the Derby, you were going to be too good for this field this afternoon. We had a good field, but we've seen better quality horses running running in this kind of race before, so he stood out class-wise, and as you can see right here, he was just playing too good, and he could run all day. He could run 2 miles. Very, very game.
Kinnane never panicked.
Exactly.
He was very patient. If he didn't make the move when Day made his move, he might have got caught in a squeeze play with Ballingarry.
That's what it would have looked like right there, and he was kind of fortunate that the Tin Man went on with it. If the Tin Man had backed up and with anticipation had gone around him, he could have found himself boxed in, but as it was, it turned out perfect. Very patient ride. That's his game. Mile and a half on the turf, a 51 for the half mile. Those guys know how to ride those kind of races.
Yes, it was a one-paced race for three quarters until the champion picked it up, and we'll check the official order of finish for the Breeders' Cup turf. High Chaparral is your winner. The Coolmore Stud from Ireland get their victory today. With anticipation, nice try, second best. Falcon Flight, too much to do, finished third. The big disappointment today, Golan, who was off poorly, did not train particularly well all week here at Arlington, did not offer any run at all today in this race. Mick Kinnane gets the congratulations. Some tough luck earlier in the day for the Coolmore people, but High Chaparral is the winner, and Michael Tabor will join the victorious owners in the winner's enclosure here at Arlington Park. This Coolmore Stud operation is at the top of the international game, and they are exchanging handshakes following a big win. More in a moment from Arlington Park.
Don't let your emotions control you.
NBC Monday, a two-hour Third Watch event. A final showdown between New York's finest.
This guy has no weaknesses.
And the Russian mob. This is the episode where a war finally ends.
Put the gun down. Put it down.
All new Third Watch and Judgment Day, NBC Monday.
Basil Family of Dealerships invites you to watch the excitement of NASCAR this weekend. Right here on Channel 2, on your side.
It's a terrifying nightmare of warehouse inventory at both FWS stores. So on Tuesday, for 11 dreadfully delightful hours, you can shop, shop, shop for all kinds of treasures for your home at prices to die for. Creepy carpeting starting at $1.77 a square yard. Deadly delicious fabrics from 77 cents a yard. Evil temptations will abound in every department. Only 11 ectoplasmic hours to turn the FWS nightmare into your sweet dream.
What to do? Come out for the Phillips Brothers Fall Woodworking Show and Tool Sale. You'll see new products, live demos, and register for great prizes. Log on to WGRZ.com for information. What to do from Channel 2 on your side. Channel 2 News, Scott Levin on your side.
You are looking at High Chaparral, who is just run off and hidden from everybody in the Breeders' Cup turf. He is on his way home now after having his win picture made to have a bath and cool out. Job well done. A brilliant performance. But his connections are still in the winner's circle, and Mike Battaglia is with them.
Thanks, Charlsie. And a bit of a bittersweet victory for Michael Tabor and the Magners. Of course, condolences on Landseer early on. Hopefully this one made up for it just a little bit. To make the trophy presentation, we have Dennis Stewart, the National Manager of Sales for John Deere, and quite appropriately, John O'Donohue, who's the Minister of Arts, Spirits, and Tourism in Ireland. Gentlemen?
On behalf of John Deere Company and our dealers, we'd like to congratulate you on a great win of the John Deere $2 million turf race. Great race.
And how about a word from Ireland?
Well, this is a wonderful day for Irish horse racing, and some of its principal characters are here. They are wonderful ambassadors for the sport, and I think that it goes to show that you can't beat an Irish horse on its day.
You can't beat an Irish horse on its day, he said, and this was High Chaparral's day.
It certainly was. It was a slow run race, and it worried me a little bit, but he came through well. And I think at the end of the day, as Mick said, he won quite comfortably.
He really did. And Aidan O'Brien, Aidan, come on in here. Just a great job with this horse. He had reeled off six in a row. Of course, he was one of the horses that came down with the virus in your barn back in June. Had to give him about 3 months off and brought him back in the arc, a race that he evidently needed. Today, he was in top form.
Yeah, and there, I should have given him a prep run, and we didn't get a prep run into him, and Mick just thought that he rode very rusty, but he was very happy with him, and like we thought, he came on a lot from the run, and he's a horse with an half lot of class. Like he'll have no problem dropping back in trip, I think, next year.
And did you think, it looked at a lot of us like Mick was asking him to run and really wasn't getting any run with that slow pace. That finally, when he did kick in, the horse really exploded.
Yeah, it was a slow race, but Mick was always happy in where he was. He said this when he got daylight, then when he asked him to quicken, he said there was never any doubt.
And Mick Canaan, tell us about the trip you got. You said you've had a couple of bad trips here so far this afternoon, but this one made up for it.
Yeah, we just didn't have much luck with the rock, and this has made up for it. Yeah, it's this is a good colt. He's a bit idle, but once that gap opened up, he quickened up, and the race was over.
Well, congratulations. Great job all around. Gentlemen, High Chaparral, winner of the turf.
Thank you, Mike. And that is the end of the Breeders' Cup Turf, and here we're ready for the Classic, and there is War Emblem, your Kentucky Derby winner, your Preakness winner, and your Morning Line favorite for the Breeders' Cup Classic. There had been great speculation over who would be the Morning Line favorite between War Emblem, Medaglia d'Oro, and Came Home, and this is the way it shaped up. War Emblem was 3-1. Medaglia d'Oro wound up second choice at 7-2. Came Home wound up third choice at 4-1. He just can't get no respect.
So, Chelsea, another big day of racing already, but as you've indicated, the best still to come, the final race on the card, the $4 million Breeders' Cup Classic featuring War Emblem. After his remarkable victories in the Kentucky Derby and the Preakness earlier this year, the charismatic colt became, at least for a while and up until now, America's horse. And today's Classic is not only the final race of War Emblem's career, it's also a homecoming. This is Barn 1 at Arlington Park. 6 months ago, this was War Emblem's home. He was then the property of an 84-year-old steel plant owner from Chicago named Russell Reinemann. Reinemann kept War Emblem at Arlington Park with a relatively unknown trainer named Bobby Springer. His racing career began here in Chicago, and on a circuit anonymous to many, he'd surprised by capturing the Illinois Derby. Reinemann didn't have the money to keep him, and soon after, he'd be sold to a Saudi prince and his Thoroughbred Corporation for $1 million. The prince handed his new prize to the silver-haired trainer with the golden touch, and a month later, they traveled to the Mecca of horse racing. And on that first Saturday in May, he went from being a long shot to the only one with a shot at racing's most legendary prize.
War Emblem has won the Derby in front-running fashion. And they're off.
On to Pimlico, where many believe War Emblem's magic was sure to run out.
He wins the Preakness, and it's on to Scotland for a triumphant tribute run.
Now this unknown black colt was his sport's shining star, and everyone's eyes were on the horse who had a chance to join the legends of racing. But racing luck was cruel at Belmont, and War Emblem was left to race another day.
And a huge disappointment today for War Emblem.
In the months that followed, the story would take another turn. Prince Ahmed bin Salman, the man who purchased War Emblem and brought him to the Derby, died of a heart attack at age 43. Today, War Emblem comes home to the very track where he once trained in obscurity. And where now he is the biggest name on racing's biggest day. Hoping for one last big moment in this, the final race of his career. War Emblem running for a $4 million purse and perhaps Horse of the Year honors. Eventful year for War Emblem, Charlesy. Two-thirds of the Triple Crown, and he's been sold twice.
He has indeed. He's now, after today's race is over, he becomes the property of Shadai Farm in Japan. They spent $17 million for him. He's going there to stand at stud. They recently lost the wonderful Sunday Silence, and obviously they're looking to fill his position. So War Emblem will be leaving the country after this race.
go down to Bob Neumeier.
War Emblem is very keyed up for this race. Bob Baffert tried to saddle this horse unsuccessfully and will try again as we're down in the paddock here at Arlington Park. This is a very interesting situation here with this race, and that is War Emblem and Medaglia d'Oro and Came Home, the other fine three-year-olds, have not run since August, and this is a very almost European style of training, if you will. It's very unusual. And if any of these fine three-year-olds, War Emblem or Came Home or Medaglia d'Oro, win this race, it'll be off the longest layoff in the history of the Breeders' Cup Classic. And I think that's one of the interesting storylines. That combined with the fact that certainly War Emblem was the horse of the spring, winning the Derby and winning the Preakness, and Bobby Frankel's Medaglia d'Oro was the horse of the fall. He was sensational at Saratoga in winning the Travers. Came Home, the gritty little Californian, he too a fine three-year-old that's going to try to win this race off a layoff. There are older horses here, Evening Attire, that has been terrific of late. It shapes up as a magnificent classic. I'm just hoping Bob Baffert can somehow get a saddle on War Emblem, because he's a handful down here in the paddock at Arlington Park. And certainly the Derby winner and the Preakness winner and the winner of the Illinois Derby is possibly, and I say possibly, if he runs his race today, certainly could be the horse of the year in the calendar year 2002. Let's go to the Kenny Rice.
Bob, good point about the layoff, and no Breeders' Cup winner has ever gone 2 months from his last race until winning it, and one of those three-year-olds trying to do it is Came Home. The last time he was out on the track, he was there getting a win in the Pacific Classic in his first race against older horses, and he beat, among others that day, War Emblem, as you see Paco Gonzalez now, who is working back there to get the saddle up on Came Home. Came Home in his career has won 9 of 11 races. His only 2 losses have been outside of the state of California. We will see what he does today, but it has been a time to ask questions of Paco Gonzalez a lot about how good he's doing. Paco, quickly, how's he looking? How's the 2 months been since we last saw him race?
Well, you can see him, how he looks.
He looks good.
He looks good to me. He's doing very good.
Have you worked him particularly hard? What was your training method like for him, knowing that he was not going to race for 2 months before this one?
No, I train him normal like I always train him. You know, just I give him a couple long works, like, you know, because we got plenty of time for that race. That's all I do. You know?
You said earlier, it always questions about this horse. Could he get the mile late? He did that in the Santa Anita Derby. Could he get the mile and a quarter? And he beat the older horses in the Pacific Classic. Yeah. He keeps answering the questions.
Yeah, I guess he answered the questions.
Okay, congratulations on a good season. Good luck today. Paco Gonzalez with Came Home. Now let's go over to Bob and check up on War Emblem.
Well, Bob Baffert is attempting for the second time to put the saddle on the Derby and Preakness winner. The grooms walked him a couple of times, the assistant trainers around the paddock, just to settle down War Emblem if they can. And you can see how Bob is struggling just to saddle this magnificent champion. It's interesting that an onlooker here around the paddock is, in fact, Russell Reinemann, who's the gentleman who sold War Emblem to the Thoroughbred Corporation. And Russell is with me now. And Russell, what are you thinking going into this classic, the one that got away?
Well, we sure hope we can win it. You know that, I'll tell you. He's a great horse. Hope you do what you need. Not an easy race, though.
People have asked you, I know, all year long, is it the biggest mistake you ever made in your life selling this horse?
I think it's the biggest good move I've made.
Good move?
Yeah, sure. Well, you know, it's one of those things.
You had to sell him at the time, correct?
Well, my stable industry is so bad. That's one of the reasons I had to do this. It's all worked out great.
And you're delighted, and you'd love to see him win today, I imagine.
I sure would. It'd be a great asset, you know that.
And as an old Chicago guy, this is your track, right?
Been my track for many years, I'll tell you, ever since I've lived here.
There you have it, folks. The irony here, Russell Reinemann, the original owner of War Emblem, who sold it to the Thoroughbred Corp, is here to see his former Illinois Derby champion try to win the Breeders' Cup Classic.
Numi, thank you very much. We're taking a look here at Paco Gonzalez, who spends all his time with his horses, and Mike Smith, who took over from Chris McCarron on Came Home.
Centuries of breeding, endless attention and education, countless days of training, now distilled to a single moment in time and a single goal. Performance. Performance. Made possible by many skilled people spanning generations. Performance, Bessemer Trust, enhancing private wealth for generations.
Now enjoy Guinness anywhere. Authentic Guinness draft in a bottle.
Have you ever dreamed about owning a private jet? Why dream? NetJet's fractional aircraft ownership makes it possible and affordable. The best aircraft, the most experience, and the financial resources to ensure the highest standards in safety, security, and reliability. More of the world's most successful individuals and companies choose NetJets. Why not you? NetJets. Everything else is just a plane.
The 4 has the top trainer stats in the race.
Jeremy, you've got to be kidding.
It's the 5 all the way.
5's got no chance. 7's got the best bias speed figure.
Bobby, I love the 2. The Tomlinson number said I'll love the draft.
Hey, you guys ready to order yet?
Sure, I'm starting.
No. Come back later.
Just come back after that.
In horse racing, even the experts can't agree on much, except for one thing.
Bobby, come on, I'm really hungry.
Shut up and read the form.
It's Long John Silver's boatload of seafood. Crunchy shrimp, batter dip shrimp, plus our famous batter dip fish and sides. Our biggest variety platter ever, just $6.99. Our biggest combo, just $3.99. So much great seafood for such a great price, it turns any place into seafood country.
Thanksgiving weekend. Churchill Downs. Hollywood Park. Calder Racecourse. 3.5 million in stakes. A lot more reasons to give thanks. Thanksgiving weekend. Only on CDSN. Bet on it.
Arena football, demonstrated by Kurt Warner and John Elway. Arena quarterbacks pass almost every play. Score so high you'll need oxygen. Running for the sidelines? What sidelines? The Arena Football League, Season 17, coming to NBC. Football is in the house.
Ah, the Windy City and its dreams of a fall classic, finally realized courtesy of an all-star lineup of Thoroughbreds. Team Baffert, Ken War emblem, in and out of Arlington Park. Bobby Frankel's lousy luck at the Breeders' Cup mirrors the Cubs. Is Medaglia d'Oro his streak buster? And Paco Gonzalez hopes came home can come home with a victory. Each dreams of becoming a part of classic history.
Easy door with one final acceleration and Sunday silence holds on. Awesome performance in the classic. It is Skipaway who crushed the opposition today. Back tie affair and a front running masterpiece. Where that head to lead, Eddie Jiba, the final surge, the two Derby winners hit the wire together. The incomparable, invincible, unbeatable Sagar. His man fights on, here's the wire, desperately close, Tisnell wins it.
Big surprise, War Emblem, third choice behind Medaglia d'Oro and Evening Attire at 4-1. And the current odds, will turn it over to Chelsea.
All right, and as you see, Medaglia d'Oro now at 3-1. And Evening Attire, the older horse, getting a lot of attention at 4-1. And War Emblem fading down to 9-2. Big prices on most of the rest. Came home, still not getting any respect. But let's meet the field for this classic. Combined earnings of $18,271,036 these horses have earned. Here's number one, E. Dubai from Godolphin. He has speed on the rail. Watch for him to go to the lead. What he does is really key to War Emblem's strategy in this race. The two of them could wind up battling it out. Here's Volpone. He's a true sixth man. He has switched racing surface 7 times and raced everywhere from 3/4 of a mile to a mile and a half, he's wearing blinkers today for the first time. And here is War Emblem. Bob Baffert felt his Derby winner was sour this summer. He seems to be thriving now after having a vacation and obviously has been happy since he's been here. Gave Bob a little bit of a fit in the paddock getting saddled, but behaving actually quite well here. He schooled in the gate the day he got here, stood very well, and is set for a big race, I believe. Here's Dollar Bill. This is the colt, if you remember, from last year's Kentucky Derby. He got stood on his head. He's always closing ground late, but never seems to quite get there. But he could be a part of the exotics, picking up a piece of it. Perfect Drift was third in this year's Kentucky Derby, but he really disappointed in the Belmont. He got a nice vacation. He's fresh and fit, had a good race under his belt, and could run a big race here this afternoon. Macho Uno was a game winner of the juvenile over Point Given 2 years ago. He's been pretty inconsistent since then, but he's very capable on his best day. He can jump up and run a big race. He is not getting much attention here today, but there's back class in this horse. Don't know if it'll come forward today or not. And here is Medaglia d'Oro, who the one who's getting all the attention at the windows right now. He's trained by Bobby Frankel. He's a strong strapping colt. He ran a big race off a layoff to win the Jim Dandy and then came back and won the Travers. And Bobby liked the way he did that, decided he would just give him a nice break. He remembered last year with Aptitude, who left his race in the Jockey Club Gold Cup and disappointed in the Classic as the favorite, so he wasn't going to let that happen again. Here's Evening Attire. This is the older horse that's getting all the attention at the windows. He has been typecast as an off-track specialist, but cooler weather is really the key for this horse, and he's certainly going to get that today. He has really flourished since he's been here. Pat Kelly brought him out really early, and he's trained well over this track for about 10 days now. Here's Harlan's Holiday. He won the Florida Derby for Ken McPeak back in the spring. He won the Pennsylvania Derby for Todd Fletcher in late summer. This fellow tries hard no matter who trains him. And Hawkwing was being reshod in the paddock, but he's caught up with the post parade. Here he is. Aiden O'Brien, trainee, has been first or second in six straight European Grade Ones. He's a son of Woodman, so the question is, will he handle American Dirt? It's 50-50. If he does, watch out. And here's Came Home. He's won six of seven starts this year. He's all class and courage, and yet he continues to be overlooked, and frankly, his connections are starting to get a little bristly at the slight. But he will be trying very hard at the end. The mile and a quarter is the question. And here's Milwaukee Brew, also from the Bobby Frankel stable. He's a son of the inaugural Classic winner, Wild Again. He's a little hard to gauge, but his best race puts him right there. He really didn't handle the track at Belmont Park in his last start. And that's the field for the Classic. We'll go down now to our handicappers. They have a very special guest.
Well, thank you, Charles C. And if War Emblem wins this race, I think most people think he will be the horse of the year. With me is his trainer, Bob Baffert. And Bob, first an obvious question. Does he absolutely, positively, flat out need the lead to win this race?
Well, I think what he needs to do, you got to let him run early. He likes to be out there with her at his own cruising speed. He has his high cruising speed. And so if you try to take that away from him, you take the fight out of him like you would a fish, you know. And he wants to get out there, he wants to be in front. So it's one of those things where I told Victor, you get him out of the gate today. I said, you just ride him like you did in the Kentucky Derby. Just get out there, and if they leave you alone, fine. If they don't, well, that's just the way it goes, but put him on the lead.
All right, incidents at the Belmont and also the Pacific Classic. Is this a bad gate horse, in your opinion?
No, I think he just had some bad racing luck. You know, this horse, I think maybe the Triple Crown was catching up, but that day it was just he just took a bad step. He was moving. It wasn't meant to be. And in Del Mar, it was just bad. I shouldn't have run him there. He was trying to tell us that, you know, maybe he didn't want to run or whatever.
Why shouldn't you have run him in that race?
I think he was too close to his race. Had the Haskell, it was very hot, and he came back. He worked way too fast, and I just let the pressure get to me. We ran the horse, and now I freshen him up, and they should see the real War Emblem.
And I know you're emotional because this is the last hurrah, win, lose, or draw.
It's very, you know, usually I get really tense and excited, but this is the last time we get to run him. He goes to Japan, and so I just hope he goes out a winner.
Good luck, Bob.
Thank you.
All right, let's bring in Mike Battaglia now for the analysis. And, Michael, do you like War Emblem in this spot?
I love War Emblem in this spot. I've been in love with this horse since his Kentucky Derby. He ran one of the best Kentucky Derbies I've seen in a long time. His closing quarter was fantastic that day. He came back, and he showed he could run again in the Preakness. And I just think he's a victim of bad luck. He's won four out of his last six. The two that he lost were bad luck. I think you'll see the real War vindication in the juvenile. He's trained, War Emblem up to the race, and I think he's really, really sitting on a big race.
Well, clearly he was the horse of the spring.
Yeah, go off the way there.
He's schooling him right here, Bob, in the gate Thursday morning. And, you know, it didn't look like, Bob said that he didn't think that this was a bad gate horse, but he has taken him to the gate a couple of times since then, and I think he is a little bit worried. I think the start is crucial.
Which proves to me he's recognizing it as an issue.
Yes, he has to recognize it as an issue, and we talked about the start being an issue in the sprint. I think the start is a big issue today for War Emblem.
And he Dubai has speed as well, but the horse of the fall, even though he lost to this great champion, War Emblem, early on two occasions, has to be Medaglia d'Oro of the Bobby Frankel barn, and there's a good look. Jerry Bailey up, sensational at Saratoga. Didn't beat anything in the Jim Dandy, no doubt about that, but in the Travers Stakes, he beat Repent, who's a darn good horse off a layoff, and he did it on a sloppy, muddy track. Took the fight to these horses on the get-go, and as you can see him just skipping over the water at the Spa and drawing clear and winning by a length and a half, turning aside Repent. But certainly Jerry Bailey and Medaglia d'Oro has trained beautifully all week. Again, this layoff angle is fascinating, Mike, as Baffert, Frankel, and Gonzalez, who train all three of these three-year-olds, have decided to train their horses rather than race them into the Breeders' Cup Classic. It's almost unprecedented.
It really is, and I talked to Bobby Frankel in the paddock, and I asked him about that. He said, the horse has never been better. I said, what about War Emblem getting loose on the lead? He said, don't think it's going to happen. He said, I told Jerry Bailey to put this horse in the race early, so look for some early speed out of Medaglia d'Oro. Maybe he'll try to go up and challenge War Emblem in the early going.
All right, let's talk about one or two other horses that we think can run in here, and certainly Evening Attire is getting a lot of play, number 8 off the big win in the Jockey Club Gold Cup.
He should be. This is a legitimate late runner. He's in top form right now. If these horses get out there and burn themselves out, he's going to be the one that's running at the end under Sean Bridgemahan, and how can you knock Came Home?
No, Came Home has been just sensational. Again, he's the horse that gets no respect. There is Bridgemahan on the gray, and as Chelsea pointed out before, he's kind of been typecast as an off-track horse. There is moisture in the track today, but it has dried magnificently throughout the day, and Evening Attire was an off-the-pace threat, no doubt.
Big question
with the speed in the race, and again, you know, if it sets up and they go banging heads, E. Dubai and War Emblem and Medaglia d'Oro and even Came Home, maybe Evening Attire can pick up the pieces.
Right, and how about Mike Smith? He's already had two wins. Wouldn't this be a fitting end to his day with Came Home?
All right, so Mike likes War Emblem. I like this horse, Medaglia d'Oro. What about the Cyber Cappers throughout the country? Interesting. War Emblem, 27%, even though he is, the present time, is
he's
not the favorite here in Arlington. He's the favorite with our Cyber Cappers, 27%.
And the favorite with me, Bob.
Frankel's Medaglia d'Oro, 18%. There's Baffert.
And Baffert looked very confident. When he was down here talking, he looked very confident. He's usually a little bit nervous. I think he was, but knowing that this is War Emblem's last race, he seemed pretty confident that he had him trained up, and he thought that that horse was probably in top shape. And Kenny Rice has a report. Let's go to Kenny.
Well, Evening Attire is really a family operation. Hall of Fame trainer Tom Kelly is the co-breeder and co-owner. His son Patrick Kelly is the trainer. Before Patrick, his brother Tim used to train him. He came over to Patrick's barn about a year and a half ago. He has been developing about the right time, said Patrick Kelly to me earlier this week. He's coming on a lot like his sire, Black Tie Affair, who had a 7-week layoff and then came back to win the Breeders' Cup Classic. In this case, though, he's been running well up to it, having won that Jockey Club Gold Cup the last part of September, just less than a month ago. And there you see the big gray loading in now. Let's go up to Tom Durkin with the call of the Breeders' Cup Classic.
And they're at the post for the Breeders' Cup Classic. The final horses taking their spot. War Emblem goes into post position number 3. At 4-1, the odds board reading here at Arlington. And there is Hawkwing, Mick Canaan, aloft. Canaan just successful in the Breeders' Cup turf with High Chaparral. Long shot, perfect drift in post number 5. And here the compact colt from California, Came Home. A lot of support at the windows at 6-1 here. And the final horse moving into line will be late running long shot, Milwaukee Brew. 12 set for the 19th Breeders' Cup Classic, and we are ready for the start. resting himself in the saddle there. And they're off. Your emblem away well, but E. Dubai got the jump on him, firing right off the mark. Came home on the outside, and Medallion Oro comes on through. E. Dubai is the leader as they race for the first turn. On the outside, Medallion Oro. War Emblem is in between horses. He's running second now, and he'll go on to challenge E. Dubai into the clubhouse turn. Perfect Trip takes to the inside in fourth. Falpony rides the rails in fifth. Came Home is hustled up on the outside from sixth now. Mike Smith wants to get him closer. He's six lengths from front running E. Dubai. Macho Uno is now running in mid-pack, and he's seventh. Harlan's Holiday is eighth. Milwaukee Brew is ninth. Hawkwing is unhurried, a bit wide going into the backstretch. Four lengths back to the stretch runner Evening Attire. And the last of them all is Dollar Bill, and he is 12 lengths from the front runners, and they're moving right along here. A testing opening half mile by E. Dubai in 46 and 3/5 seconds, and War Emblem is chasing him in earnest. He's under a hustling ride there by Espinosa, and Perfect Drift is just coasting along in third. Medallion Oro fourth with 5 furlongs to go here. Toward the inside, Valpony bottled up in fifth. And then it's Harlan's Holiday, sixth as they approach the far turn. Macho Uno is moving up methodically on the inside, and Came Home is coming up empty. Hawkwing is now beginning to circle horses on the far outside. Hawkwing's in here. So too is Milwaukee Brew, rounding the far turn, and the Derby winner's in front. War Emblem has taken over, but Medallion Oro is right there in his throat latch, and Valpony comes charging on through as the field turns for Home.
Tells those young soft sophomores goodbye. This is one for the older boys. I'm a four-year-old, and I can beat you guys. He's by Crypto Clearance, who is a real distance-loving, off-track-loving horse. So this slipped by all the handicappers, but he slips through the stretch. Very much a winner of the $4 million Breeders' Cup Classic. That is Vol Pony, named for a turf rider.
Sunday's number one show, Law & Order Criminal Intent, is all new. A mother is killed. A war criminal is suspect.
The screaming butcher of Tiananmen Square.
Can he track down a murderer the whole world can't find?
Don't you worry.
All new Law & Order Criminal Intent, NBC Sunday.
Play it safe this Halloween. Join Channel 2 on your side for the Gallery of Treats to benefit kids escaping drugs. For a dollar donation, fill your Halloween bag with all kinds of goodies. The Gallery of Treats, Wednesday, October 30th. See you there.
1985, Kenmore teenager John Justice kills his family and a neighbor.
We discovered three bodies.
For the past 17 years, he's been in prison. In 36 months, he's getting out.
You want to live back in Kenmore or Buffalo?
In a Channel 2 News special report, Scott Levin goes behind bars for new insight into the crime that shocked Western New York.
How do we know that you're not going to do this crime again?
And what turns kids into killers?
Do they have no hope?
John Justice, Thursday night at 11.
What to do? See the Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus October 30th through November 3rd at the HSBC Arena. It's a great time for the whole family. Log on to WGRZ.com for more information. What to do from Channel 2.
Channel 2 reminds you to set your clocks back 1 hour for daylight savings time.
Your emotions control you.
NBC Monday, a 2-hour Third Watch event. A final showdown between New York's finest.
This guy has no weaknesses.
And the Russian mob. This is the episode where a war finally ends.
Put the gun down. Put it down.
All new Third Watch and Judgment Day, NBC Monday.
And there is Jose Santos aboard the $89 winner of the Breeders' Cup Classic, Vol Pony, named for a prison guard at Rikers Island. No, that's his wife, not a prison guard. That is Rita Santos, the wife of Jose, the winning jockey. Paul Vol Pony was the prison guard that this horse was named after. He turned turf rider, wrote a very nice story about P.G. Johnson, the Chicago-born trainer that's got to be on top of the world this afternoon with this victory in this $4 million race. Let's go down to the handicappers, who I'm pretty sure didn't have any money on this one.
No, you're... And we're down here in the winner's circle and with Trevor Denman, and they're the big balloons, Trevor. $89 for Vol Pony to win. Medaglia Duro hung on for second. Milwaukee Brew kicked it in late to pick up the pieces in the show hole. P.G. Johnson, the trainer, who's a Hall of Famer, and the owners pre-entered this horse in one of the grass races. Proved to be the greatest decision they've ever made in their lives.
They look like geniuses right now, that's for sure. Could not believe that that horse won that well. He looked like a 3-5 shot at the quarter pole. He just blew right by those horses. Let's go and take a look at that stretch run right here. You see him making his move here. He's in the blue cap on the outside. And look at him. He's going by them there as though he's just joined them at the 3/8 pole. That's him number two on the inside. A Medaglia Doro in the red war emblem just ran a clinker today. I don't know what happened to him. But look at Vol Pony. Right here, I was thinking to myself, he must have the wrong horse, because this horse cannot be 40-1 and be winning this well. Look at that power. He just absolutely waltzes home down the lane. Medaglia Doro ran well. What happened to War Emblem? What happened to Came Home? Gosh, just a bad run by both of them. Kenny?
With me is Bob Baffert and Victor Espinoza from the War Emblem camp. Victor, it looked like you were in pretty good position there when you were getting to the quarter pole with him.
Well, I was good all the way around, but it's just not, he don't run his race. You know, it's not like before. For some reason, he's getting smart now, and then he just don't want to do it.
Bob, is he looking too forward to retirement, you think, before this one?
I think so. I mean, I was really disappointed. I thought he'd run a big race today, but when we came out of the gate, and I saw that Victor had a nudge on him to get him going, I said, that's not the worm we know. I think maybe just a tired horse. You know, he's fooling us. He's getting smart. When they get smart like that, they will quit running, but... I'm just glad he picked at the right time, won the Derby. We had a lot of fun with him, and I would have loved to have won this race, but I'm disappointed for the fans. He came back great, but that just, you know, they didn't get to see the real War Emblem. It's a shame.
Well, Bob, congratulations on a great run with him. Victor, congratulations, guys.
Thank you.
Bob Baffert and Victor Espinoza.
All right,
with
that
War
is
Emblem.
The winning.
Let's go to Charlesy.
Victorious Vol Pony in the winner's circle after the Breeders' Cup Classic. He is the second biggest classic upset since Archon paid $133.60 in 1993. We'll be back to interview the connections right after this.
How do you avoid getting sick when you read in a car?
Well, you don't read. Anything else? Good. This custom hydraulic system gains international appeal after a showcase at an auto show.
Center stage?
It was in the back, but had good foot traffic. Anyway, the mechanic uses FedEx Global Trade Manager to help find and print shipping documents, estimate duties and taxes, and they're on the international scene before you can say lederhosen.
Lederhosen.
Too late.
That was fast.
Not fast enough.
Lederhosen.
I printed and collated the color report that won the big account and got us into a larger office. And this is the respect I get? I need a hug.
Toshiba copiers make you look good.
Seize opportunities when they arise. Go more places. Get there faster. Get home sooner. With NetJets, the world leader in fractional aircraft ownership. NetJets makes owning a jet a smart business decision for you and your shareholders, offering all the competitive advantages of full aircraft ownership at a fraction of the cost. More successful companies and individuals choose NetJets. Why not you? NetJets. Everything else is just a plane.
You'd never hear this from John, but he owns the best car repair shop in town. He's got a well-deserved reputation for getting it right the first time. He listens to his customers, he uses top-quality Napa parts, and he backs up his work every time. Now, as much as we'd like to take credit for it, a shop like John's isn't this good because there's a Napa sign out front. Fact is, there's a Napa sign out front because John's shop is this good.
It's Long John Silver's boatload of seafood. Crunchy shrimp, batter dip shrimp, plus our famous batter dip fish and sides. Our biggest variety platter ever, just $6.99. Our biggest combo, just $3.99. So much great seafood for such a great price, it turns any place into seafood country.
NBC Wednesday, the final showdown for the White House.
Game on, boyfriend. Let's go.
The one fight.
Tired of partisan politics.
He must win.
How are we going to do it? Give me 10 after that. I'll drop out of the race right now.
Game on!
Oh, my God.
This is the one to watch. All new West Wing, NBC Wednesday.
The Breeders' Cup World Thoroughbred Championship is brought to you by NetJets. Everything else is just a plane. By John Deere, nothing runs like a deer. By Toshiba, don't copy, lead. And by Guinness Grout Stout, enjoyed responsibly the world over.
And there is Vol Pony on his way back to the barn after winning the Breeders' Cup Classic. He more than quadrupled his earnings from a little over $600,000 to well over $2 million by virtue of this victory. And here is the order of finish. It was Vol Pony outrunning Medaglia d'Oro by far to the wire. Bobby Frankel gets third with Milwaukee Brew. Evening Attire finished fourth. War Emblem finished well back in eighth. Came Home finished 10th. And that's the last we see of those two. They go off now to stud. And now we'll go down to Mike Battaglia in the winner's circle with all the winning connections.
What an upset in the Classic. Owner Kathy Johnson, Edward Bear, Phil Johnson, a great job of training. Jose Santos, what a ride to make the presentation. We have the Honorable George Ryan, the governor of Illinois, along with Tim Smith, the commissioner of the NTRA, and governor, it's all yours.
Thanks very much. On behalf of the people of the state of Illinois, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to give you this trophy. Jose, congratulations to you, to the Bears, to the Johnsons, everybody. Congratulations. Magnificent win. That's pretty heavy. Congratulations, too, guys.
Congratulations, guys. We're sorry. We're really out of time, but it is your anniversary, I hear, tomorrow. Congratulations on that. Great job of training, Jose. Great ride and a huge upset here. Vol Pony wins the Classic. A quick comment about getting this horse ready, Phil. Quick comment.
It was easy. He's a nice horse. That makes it easy.
He's a nice horse, and you did a job. Your trip, real quick, Jose, good job.
Can't be better. You know, I get frosted to the wire.
Oh, great job by all of the connections here. The day ends on a huge upset.
All right, Mike, it was Joe Zazzari beginning the day with a commanding performance in the distaff. A victorious return to the Breeders' Cup for jockey Mike Smith. A triumphant debut for Laura Desereau. Storm Flag Flying showed plenty of heart in winning the juvenile fillies for Shug McGehee. Then in the mile, European superstar Rock of Gibraltar could not roll to victory, opening the door for long shot Dome Driver. In the sprint, 45-1 shot, Thunderello led late but was overtaken by Orientate, extending the Breeders' Cup victory records of trainer Dwayne Lucas and jockey Jerry Bailey. In the filly and mare turf, Starine surged to victory. A satisfying second Breeders' Cup win for Bobby Frankel. Vindication is the early Derby favorite after a juvenile win. Mike Smith's second victory in his Breeders' Cup comeback. Aiden O'Brien claimed his victory in the turf with High Chaparral and Mick Kinane. And in a classic shocker, it was Valpony, the 4-year-old 40-1 shot trained by Hall of Famer Phil Johnson, who lit up the tote board and claimed the $4 million Breeders' Cup Classic. The greatest day in thoroughbred racing lives up to its advanced billing. That'll do it from Arlington Park. For all of us here at NBC, so long.